Brokenshire again. Are you ready for the second lap of our big bumpy journey? The first part here is devoted to another aspect of the East-West power struggle, the uneasy subject of aggression. Fasten all seat belts. Here we go.
This is Radio Moscow, and here is the news.
In view of reports that North American aircraft are violating the airspace of Brazil, and that in the region of the Amazon, radar stations are being built, Deputy to the Federal Senate, Braga, has petitioned the government to state whether it is aware of these activities. In spite of the world scandal created by the fiasco of the open intervention of the United States against Cuba, there is material evidence that the United States is preparing for a repetition of this attack, again under the leadership of the CIA. It has become known that President Kennedy gave instructions to the Central Intelligence Agency to increase the recruiting of new mercenaries for a second invasion, which will be combined with acts of sabotage. A Cuban radio announces that an American aircraft carrier invaded Cuban territorial waters today and shelled a beach at Siboney near Santiago. Five jet planes rose from the aircraft carrier and made menacing flights over Siboney. The radio announcement called this provocation another aggressive act against Cuba by American imperialism.
Vice President Johnson's tour of Southeast Asia has done absolutely nothing to promote world peace. He told the press conference that the United States was prepared to take any decisions and any risk in that area. It almost sounds like the late John Foster Dulles announcing the start of another brink of war adventure, doesn't it? We may expect another sharpening of the situation in Southeast Asia as the United States interferes more energetically.
About 100,000 people in six provinces of southern Vietnam took part in rallies and demonstrations against the increasing interference by the United States in their affairs. They insisted that American imperialists get out of southern Vietnam and called dictator Ngo Dinh Diem a traitor.
Small war is to be the means of putting the new yoke on the emancipated nations.
It is most interesting to know that small nations are emancipated only when they adopt communism. Also, we have heard strong accusations about our role in Southeast Asia. And we may well ask if a nation must remain passive in those circumstances involving the current situation in Southeast Asia. Now we shall hear about Kuwait.
More than 5,000 British soldiers are now concentrated on the Iraqi border. British warships, including the carrier Bulwark and the frigates Loch Elvie and Mion, are anchored in Kuwait territorial waters. The Iranian newspaper Kayhan admits that Kuwait has been turned into a huge military camp. For scores of years, the territory has been under British protection. Situated in the Persian Gulf region, Kuwait is fabulously rich in oil. By exploiting this wealth, the American and British monopolists rake in huge profits. Last year alone, they amounted to $1,000 million. It's not surprising that to British businessmen, the loss of Kuwait would be equivalent to bankruptcy. On the other hand, it is very risky in our time to continue openly plundering Kuwait's wealth. Actually, the granting of Kuwait's alleged independence was only another colonialist trick aimed at preserving the colonial system in the country. Commentary was by Anatoly Shvatov, and it came to you from Radio Moscow.
With regard to Kuwait, we should ask that you read the printed explanation on this record jacket. Now, remember the fight over Suez? Here is the East's version of it.
The theory of so-called limited or local wars has become very popular lately in the West. What were Britain, France, and Israel after when they launched the local war against Egypt? They wanted to crush Egypt and intimidate other Arab countries fighting for their independence. It was their aim to put fear into other peoples of Asia and Africa. This adventure, as you know, ended in failure. The Soviet Union and all the other socialist countries came to Egypt's defense, and the aggressors retreated.
It is only a half-truth. The fact is, the United States did oppose Britain, France, and Israel on Suez. Next, we're going to hear something that involves an interesting point on aggression and interference. It revolves around Angola.
Can humanity reconcile itself, asks the Soviet government, with these monstrous cannibalistic plans which are being carried out for all to see and in violation of the solemn declaration of the United Nations on granting independence to the colonial countries and peoples? The answer is no. This clearly shows the connivance of all the colonialists in one another's crimes, and the Soviet government is quite right when it states that responsibility for the crimes in Angola is borne not only by Portugal, but also by its NATO allies.
Moscow Radio has just called for less interference in the affairs of underdeveloped countries and more interference in the affairs of NATO countries. May one country interfere in another's affairs without being charged with interference? And who is to pass on the morality of that interference? The three-man commissions? The troikas?
Tomorrow is the 185th anniversary of America's Independence Day. On July 4th, 1776, the American Congress passed the Declaration of Independence, a document which proclaimed the sovereignty of the new state. The declaration, written by Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin, inspired the American patriots who took up arms to defend the liberty and happiness of their country. What would Thomas Jefferson say if he could enter modern America today? He vowed that his native land would be an enemy of war. However, today he would hear certain American politicians speak of the necessity of war. In the lobbies of Congress, he would be able to talk with a swarm of politicians preaching a strong-armed policy and hatred between the peoples. We shall not delve into history and recall the capture of Mexican lands, the Philippines, or the invasion of the Isthmus of Panama. Let's take a look at things of a recent period. The people of Vietnam are fighting against the French colonizers. America fully supported the colonizers, supplying them with weapons and money. The people of Laos are defending their independence from the colonizers. Who is fighting against the Laotian people? They are the puppets of America, armed with American weapons and subsidized by Washington. What about the Congo? Kasavubu and Mobutu, the miserable lackeys, drawing money from the Central Intelligence Agency, murdered Patrice Lumumba, the leader of the Congolese people, dispersed parliament, and are now tearing the Congo into bits. What would Jefferson say about America's policy in relation to Cuba? When Batista, the bloody dictator, was thrown out by the people, Washington began an all-out war against Cuba, which is continuing to this very day. Was such a policy set down in the Declaration of Independence?
All the way back to the Mexican War? After all, we only took away Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, and a part of California, didn't we? We did leave them something, didn't we? Now, in Latin America, it is quite true that we are not universally liked and admired. How would you have liked to accompany Adlai Stevenson in his swing around South America? Here it is, Radio Moscow reporting.
By the President of the United States, with the special mission of compelling the governments of South America to support the anti-Cuban policy of the White House, Mr. Stevenson has visited Venezuela, Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, Chile, Paraguay, Bolivia, Peru, and Ecuador. From the newspaper reports of the last few days, the conclusion can be drawn that Mr. Stevenson's mission has been defeated, except in the case of the dictatorial regime in Paraguay and the corrupt clique which is in power in Peru. He has not succeeded in forcing the governments of the Latin American countries to come out openly against revolutionary Cuba. As the Mexican paper Prensa shows, official circles in the countries of Latin America have received Washington's representative with cold reserve and irritation. Thus, the government of Venezuela told Stevenson that it was indignant at the unceremonious manner in which the American oil companies were making themselves at home in the country. Ruling circles in Argentina protested against United States dumping. In Bolivia, the State Department's political peddler was met with firing in the streets.
And from Radio Havana, we hear this familiar phraseology.
Latin America knows all too well what the work of Wall Street imperialism is worth. they know it is fully capable of saying Alliance for Progress when it means, in reality, Alliance for Misery. After all, look at all the tragic experience the countries south of the Rio Grande have had.
This is Radio Havana, Cuba.
Next comes a deadly serious subject, that of West Berlin and the threat of aggression. Aggression, Eastern style.
Every person, if not deprived of common sense, sees and understands that the signing of a peace treaty is the way to improving relations between states. The granting to West Berlin of the status of a free city would mean that all countries of the world wishing to maintain economic and cultural ties with the city would have the right and possibilities to freely exercise these ties. Of course, agreement would have to be reached with the country across whose territory pass the communications that link West Berlin with the outside world. If any country violates peace and crosses the borders, ground, air, or water, of another country, it will assume full responsibility for the consequences of the aggression and will receive a proper rebuff. There are some in the West who threaten us, saying that if we sign a peace treaty, it will not be recognized, and that even arms will be brought into play to prevent its implementation. Evidently, they forget that times are different now. We are capable of giving a proper rebuff to any use of force, and we have what is needed to defend ourselves. West Berlin has been turned into a center for espionage and provocations against the socialist world. America's refusal to find a reasonable solution to the Berlin question suggested by the Soviet Union can lead to an explosion. That would be fatal for the United States, too.
There is no need to brandish arms, carry out mobilizations, to threaten and to blackmail. This is not a time for provocations.
Here the East is saying that the very existence of a West Berlin within their borders is uncomfortable and an irritation to them. They also oppose the reestablishment of the same united Germany that has already started two world wars. The East threatens to go to war over the issue. Before a power struggle develops into a nuclear struggle, it might be a good thing to put the real issues in the Berlin dispute well out in public view.